Děkujeme. Thanks for coming. As you know, this is Postfascismus in Europe, Postfascism in Europe, roundtable discussion with Gaspar, Miklós, Tamás, and our three other guests, which are Jaroslav Fiala, Michal Hauser, and Lukáš Matoška. We'll get to all of them in just a moment, but first want to thank the Rosa Luxemburg Stiftung for financially supporting the event, and to remind everyone that the event is sponsored by SOK, the SOK Združení pro levicovou teorii, Association for Left Theory, and I'll make this list of books that SOK has published. I'll have it circulate. SOK has published Jacques Rancière, Alain Badiou, and a number of other authors in Czech translation. And also, please sign the attendance sheet, which should be somewhere in the back. Tak, prosím vás, je to tady předu. Tak nezapomínejte podepisovat prezenčku. So now let me get back to the introduction that I promised a moment ago. Gaspar Tamás has just, we've published a new book for him of Czech translations of his important philosophical essays on the history of the socialist movements, on state capitalist regimes and the general social situation in Central and Eastern Europe before 1991, and also on the transition and what came after, and how to understand the tortured relationship between the historic socialist movement and the communist ideal and the communist movement to which radical philosophy can aspire. So that's the new book that's the background and our excuse for inviting Gaspar to visit us today. But that book doesn't include a couple of Tamás's best-known essays. There are a couple of seats up here in front, so please come. And one of those essays is his essay on post-fascism. He's also published on similar topics, nationalism, ethnicism, and a whole range of theory that he's developed that we provided a kind of the social and political and philosophical background to in this book. But we now, today, is our chance to discuss with him the meaning of this term, post-fascism, which is, this is, I think, a very original and important concept that Tamás has provided us with in the attempt that's now become very urgent to understand what is this phenomenon that we variously know as the extreme right, the new right, neo-fascism, or in its more euphemistic version, illiberal democracy. So this is the term that Tamás has proposed, post-fascism, for understanding this phenomenon within a broad constellation of social forces that are around it. And then we've invited Jaroslav, who's a political scientist, political theorist, and publicist, Michal Hauser, philosopher, and Lukáš Matoška, publicist, and also a radio employee. we're all going to, taking off from this central concept, discuss what it means today and what we should do about it. So yeah, I think we can start then with Gaspar explaining the term to both to those who already know it and to those who don't know it, what it means yet. Thanks.
Okay. I rather stand, actually, if I may, just to see you. And thank you for having me. And more so, I'm very happy to be here, and my book has been published. It's a great event for me, so it's a nice evening, but let's don't forget that the evening may be nice for us, but it's not so nice for those people. And I won't lose too many words about explaining my old essay that has been published 16 years ago in Boston Review. And I'll say a few words about this because that's the topic, and then I'll try to develop it further and to give it a turn that might be probably topical or opposite to what the hell is happening these days that preoccupies all of us. The original concept of post-fascism, as it has been developed in quieter times than these, was the recognition that some of the features of historic fascism can be developed without any kind of totalitarian dictatorship, without any total destruction of the political superstructure, and of a seeming respect for this and that and the other, most especially, of course, for the market. And still, some of the substantial aims of historical fascist movements can be attained through so-called democratic ways, i.e. through parliamentary procedures and such. But to realize this, you have to understand what was at the foundation of both historical fascism, as we knew it, well, thank God, most of us not from personal experience, historically, and its contemporary versions. And apart from a myriad other factors, I think that the essential term there, the core, was the end of what was called at one time republicanism, which means political equality, which was developed during the Enlightenment as an idea in which human rights and political rights had been approximated, in which political rights have been attributed, at least theoretically, to all humans, the condition of a citizen, the civic condition, in principle pertains to all, and it is the duty of particular polities to make that presupposition work. In other words, in the classical parlance, to offer and to protect and to assure rights to people. When there is a theoretical and even constitutional limit to what citizenship is, when there are categories of people who aspire in vain to the title of citizen, that means the end of the Enlightenment project and the beginning of fascism. Now, a number of states, a number of polities, a number of political arrangements in this world that were aiming at limiting civic rights to some categories of people. Also, there have been people who have been prevented from forming their own states and thereby to acquire civic rights and citizenship and so on and so forth. And another method, of course, had been to limit citizenship to an extent by curtailing participation, by creating political inequality of various forms, that has created a post-Enlightenment non-free society with the extraneous accoutrements of constitutional democracy, rule of law, seemingly intact. Obviously, you know, the usual techniques of racism, sexism, class oppression, war against various minority groups in various parts of the world. There have been various forms in this, but it has been a very important change in people's thinking about these matters, and in powerful people's thinking about these matters, and in public opinion too, namely that the separation of citizenship and of the human condition have become operative again, that it has been recognized that citizenship is a privilege. After all, freedom of any kind in bourgeois society is a privilege anyway, but citizenship as a principle to be limited to some categories is a particular trait of fascist regimes. And there have been, of course, instances, I don't need to make a list of them, that exemplify this. And it has been a moment at the beginning of this millennium when many people, such as myself too, have to realize that the compromise of 1989 won't keep. That the development of recognition of rights and the civic condition that has been forced by two factors. One was the defeat of Nazism and fascism in 1945. And then, of course, the mutual deterrence and the equilibrium between the two world systems, called also the Cold War, which turned out to have been the Cold Peace. There's no war came about, thank God. That has forced both systems to build a number of social institutions, various social institutions, of course, and differences from place to place, that preserved a modicum of dignity even for subaltern classes, and to associate social rights, various welfare arrangements, various social methods of preserving dignity. That was a sort of an equilibrium of the welfare state, both in the liberal capitalist and this post-Stalinist, post-56 versions in the Soviet bloc. But after 89, there was no extraneous force to keep capitalism bound to its self-limitations and of its respect of the adversary, which is, of course, the proletariat. One, the extremist threat of the Soviet bloc doesn't exist anymore. Secondly, an old thing that we sometimes forget to mention when we speak of certain matters, the fact that the workers' movement have been defeated by fascism in the 20s and 30s is a permanent fact. The workers' movement has never really recovered. All the revolutionary initiatives after the Second World War came from outside the organized workers' movement, including 68, where partly still the traditional working class in France has played an important role. There was an arrière-garde fight in that respect. But it was called the Third World, the student movements, feminist movements, peace movements, etc., etc., etc. And the only workers' movement that has been victorious, Solidarnosc, has departed in many respects from the tradition of the workers' movement. In some respects, not, actually. But the workers' movement as an independent or autonomous force that could limit the majesty and the unlimited power and glory of capitalism doesn't exist any longer. And although, of course, some remnants and some sequels exist, and it's not a totally finished story, as you know, nevertheless, the constraints that capitalism has suffered from various places, so that also capitalism was limited by the past. In the first half of the 20th century, dynasties great churches, great landowners, London state, aristocracy, still played a role. Europe was still a continent with huge peasant populations. The pre-capitalist past also played a limiting and moderating role. There was a conservatism that, you know, the alliance of throne and altar, that was of course decadent and disappearing, but still it was there and it played a role and it has influenced many things. And both that has disappeared. So as it were, the moderating influences from the right have disappeared from the past, and also the moderating and limiting influences from the future, as it were, from the side of proletarian socialism. Okay. That's a very superficial sketch of what I said about this and since. But now I would like to add a few things that I haven't written about yet. There's one thing that we should really look at very carefully. The point at which fascist systems materialize, it's always at the limit of economy and politics, and it always was a strategy of capitalist societies to save themselves by giving up a lot of its traditional convictions, habits, techniques, and behaviors. What was most conspicuous and important, politically in the long run, but fascist systems of various kinds, they were also varied, of course, was that the ruling class has relinquished part of its political power, has ceased it to relinquish it to a counter-revolutionary military or paramilitary apparat and a movement apparat, which of course exercises power in harmony with the interests of the ruling class, but it wasn't the ruling class that was governing. You can't say that the great German capital has governed Germany under Hitler. The ruling class remained the ruling class, profits didn't disappear, and the market went on, although great-scale state intervention was in place. Nevertheless, government was in the hands of a non-bourgeois, separate group of people whose main inspiration and main myth and idea was the war. These people were all coming from a veterans organization. They all came from the First World War, and that was their only mainstay ideologically. They could understand their lives only in terms of struggle. And as such, they were the exact counterparts of communism, of proletarian communism. Because the communists too, after 1917, 18, 19, came from the trenches. They were also the victims both of imperialist war and of the betrayal of social democracy. And they too knew that if they wanted to attain what they wanted, it was armed struggle that would get them the desired results. That was the lesson of the trenches. They learned the lesson of violence. And because always the interest, the main interest of capitalism was, of course, to defeat proletarian socialism, it was this group of counter-revolutionary cadre, mostly military people, and quite a few paramilitary ones, but trained in war, who were the only ones capable of beating proletarian communism at its own game. The main aim of National Socialism especially, but also Italian fascism and so on, was of course not what they said to their supporters, the fight against liberal capitalism, that was the ideology, well described by Herbert Marcuse, and the importance of the anti-liberal struggle in the Nationalsozialistische Staatsaufpassung, yeah, it sounds much better in German, state doctrine, And but it was, of course, the anti-communist struggle. The aim was to smash communism, and in that they succeeded. That was the struggle for capitalism, but not the fight of capitalism itself. And it was not already in the name of capitalism. It was in the name of the race, and it was the name of the struggle, and the name of a rebirth of a society that was a non-class society, not in the sense of being a classless society, but in the sense of a society based on something allegedly more profound, that is something outside society, namely nature, namely race, of course. Now, okay, so that was the element, you know, in which the proportions and the rapport de force between rulers and governors has changed. Of course, it has been seen that, that the roots were there already in Bonapartism, as discovered already by Marx, how indeed could proletarian masses be mobilized against socialism in a military and nationalist manner. Everything has a precedent, everything has a past, so has fascism. And although it's a very modern and contemporary phenomenon. Now, when we don't have communist movements, large communist movements, and the dangers besetting capitalism are of a different nature, the solutions of post-fascists are more variegated. In some East European countries, for example, and in some Asian countries, it is indeed state groups that are taking over governing, also taking over some functions of the ruling class, not changing anything in the structure of capitalist society, but managing to mobilize also anti-capitalist energies. You know, the most, you know, for me, the most obvious example, of course, is Hungary, where you have a government calling capitalism, as many people do, calling capitalism neoliberalism, which has the added advantage, apart from blaming capitalism, blaming economic doctrine for the ills of capitalism, and also it has the added advantage of appearing foreign. Neoliberals are by definition foreigners. And so the Orban government and its troops are not themselves bourgeois. They may have bought up forcibly enterprises for their own gain, but that's the corrupt element, that's not interesting. Interesting for the interested, but yeah. And but the fact is that it is not the bourgeoisie, it's not the capitalist class, it's not the foreign investors govern Hungary, but a group of people whose roots are in a political movement and an ideology that also is conceiving of itself as being extraneous and foreign to capitalism, the interests of which it serves very well and very humbly. You know, their politics are totally neoliberal, you know, flat tax, you know, end to unemployment benefit, etc., 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 etc. Forced labor for the unemployed, like in Slovakia too, yeah, nowadays. So that's one version. Such versions exist. And of course, there are sections of the old state apparat, like in India, for example, aligned the religious forces on a governing India, also serving very well the interests of capitalism, but at the same time, of course, founding their system on caste and on race, and not on, you know, market liberty and what have you. And that seems to be just a superficial change, but it isn't. Because, of course, in any capitalist system, the main political problem is how to put people to work, to profitable work, that will serve capitalist accumulation. And if that is happening in the classical form of free labor and freedom of contract, that's the ideology of capitalism about itself. It's never purely so, but yeah. But if that changes fundamentally, if violence, coercion, state interference, regimentation play a role in putting people to work, well, that's a different system, and that has fascist characteristics. But, you know, it's not everywhere like that. You know, that also now we are witnessing a very strange and possibly clumsy attempt, for the first in a very long time, for the ruling class to govern itself. That's the, if I'm not very much mistaken, about Mr. Trump's cabinet. The cabinet of billionaires, of entrepreneurs, except, of course, Mad Dog Mattis. But he's an exception. So all these rich amateurs are now really presumed to govern. That would be interesting. But that's also it shows that there's something wrong with the classical state machinery that has accompanied capitalism until now. But whatever the technical differences between these various regimes and attempts and experiments of new anti-liberal, anti-democratic, anti-social governance, one thing is common. Namely, that they have changed fundamentally one important aspect of classical historical fascism. Classical and historical fascism was unified in the ideology of elitism. They spoke of charismatic leadership and exercised charismatic leadership and were openly contemptuous of the masses. The masses that are, you know, about what Goebbels called the socialism of quantity, that was Jewish socialism, you know. National socialism was, of course, the socialism of quality, an expression that played a very important role in Hungarian history of ideas. Quality socialism has been an idea, largely accepted cultural idea in the 1930s. Hungarian, few people know that it's come directly from Hitler and Goebbels. Anyway, and so, you know, the Nazis were thinking of themselves as Wagnerian heroes in the mist of time, you know, fighting with the forces of the underworld, being, you know, gifted with this divine inspiration. This is all gone. Now we have almost the opposite. Now, our own post-fascists are supposed to represent the common man, the ordinary folk. We are like you, well, they're not, but we are like you. That's the idea. That now, finally has come the time that those people representing not the interests, again, that's again very fascistic, not the interests, but the essence. That's always been the case of nationalism, racism, ethnicism, that is represented not the people's will, but the people's essence, right? But still they have this democratic gloss of representing the common man against estranged elites and so, you know, all this talk. And that's quite new. That's also because it's that post-fascism. It has to give itself a sort of a plebiscitarian pseudo-democratic justification. But at the same time, that's an important change. That's an important change. There are analogies. Even classical fascism, of course, has imagined its adversary as a conspiracy within the highest, identified, of course, with the Jewish elites, and the lowest, i.e., the mostly unemployed and very poor proletarians and subproletarians of the Communist parties. Don't forget that the German Communist Party, that's historically the most important warring partner of the Nazis, was a party of the unemployed, mostly. And so the explanation was, of course, that an obscure elite is using the poorest, the most desperate. That could be the best element of our people, but they are poisoned by the foreign demonic views and by the there's an element of this too. Of course, even today when, you know, it's quite interesting that elites are called groups that at least in principle and hypocritically maybe, but they're still advocating in a timorous way some sort of equality. No, I mean, don't beat up the blacks. Don't shoot them. You know, refrain if possible from mass rape. This kind of very, very, very timid, very mild, you know, that's, you know, people who would really refrain from the worst, especially if it's within their national borders and if it doesn't touch on occupied territories and the victims of their wars and such like. But even those people who, in a very, very moderate and limited way, are not in principle opposed to human equality, are considered to be elitist. And those who are for inequality are not. So to say that the idea of the common man and democratic way of thinking is in favor of inequality and discrimination, and that opposing, however timorously, discrimination and inequality is elitist, that's mind-boggling. Nevertheless, it's very successful. For a variety of reasons that I don't go into, everybody knows what they are, and even the dimmest journalist is aware of them, and they've been written up sufficiently and sufficiently well. Okay. So, but you see, these ideas, pro and con, of equality, of equal dignity, of participation, of leaders and led, of who has the political power and who are in the ruling class with or without political power, this was the problematic of the fascist era, and this is the problematic of our day too. Even if you are not directly threatened by concentration camps and gas chambers and whatnot, you're not, I think. Nevertheless, morally, politically, economically, and socially, the threats are considerable. And also, some of the threats are threats of violence and of physical coercion, too. And, you know, huge masses of people are incarcerated. I mean, innocent people are incarcerated because of what they are. As you know, racial and ethnic and national and religious denominational and gender and sexual lifestyle based discrimination is rampant everywhere. And the well-known refugee situation, to which I have sacrificed most of my time last year, is a good example of what we are faced with. So this is not a theoretical question only any longer. And two more words, can I?
Two more, sure.
Okay.
Three.
So, okay, just a few. But you know, here if you will allow me a little philosophical jargon. How is this succeeding? What fascism does successfully is to ontologize various kinds of human condition. Because you see, capitalism is a system in which your social position is in principle more or less random. You are not necessarily born into the position of a proletarian or a petit bourgeois, intellectual, or whatever. All these roles are distributed randomly by the workings of the capitalist economy. And capitalism for a long time indeed tried to keep the legal and political and social possibilities open for this randomness called also freedom in an erroneous way. In order to develop the capitalist economy. It was in their interest. But you see, that was early capitalism, that is 17th, 18th century. At least ideologically. And what fascism does, and by this has changed the political and moral and ideological character of capitalism, maybe forever, is to combine the randomness, the aleatoriness of capitalist society, in which lives, biographies are unpredictable, imprevisible, we don't know how we'll end up in this role or that, in which, you know, terms like choice have been until recently credible for naive people. And because groups to which people belong have been now redefined as natural groups. You belong to a race, you belong to a gender, you belong to a culture. That's today's great slogan, the culture, in which you are embedded to a way, in a way, according to the new ideology, that is not capable, nobody is capable of changing. What are we being told by subtle ideologists and by vulgar politicians alike? Because I don't think that the subtle columnists and propagandists are so much different from the Orbans and Zemans of this world. And they are even worse than those. Although it's difficult to imagine how, namely that if people, for example, who grew up in an Islamic culture are bound to behave in X way. People, you know, grown up and been socialized in, you know, in a Western, Christian, bourgeois, liberal society will behave differently. The aim to keep our freedom is to keep these two things apart. That is, social groups are being nationalized. Belonging to a cultural group is ontological. And that is not only going back from before the Enlightenment, it's going back from before Aristotle. And it is a very, very serious business. And it is very largely believed. Frau Merkel, how we call her, Merkelova, you know, Frau Merkelova just declared yesterday that she, the beacon of light in this darkness of Europe, if I'm not very much mistaken, will prohibit the complete veil, the burqa. Well, of course, in a more humane and democratic way than others, of course. This means that she or people like her have no substantive objection to the ontologizing and naturalizing of human categories and belongings and so on and so forth, but only want to be kinder and milder and nicer about it than others. So that's a difference of degree and not of kind. This is a capitalism, my dear friends, which cannot be considered with the best will to have anything to do with the ideas of the French Revolution and the tradition of liberalism, let alone other things. And this is what humankind will have to fight, although it has less weapons than any of our predecessors. It is one of the most difficult tasks I can imagine, and people such as yourselves who will come together in such rooms in many times of the world will have to think about things that we haven't thought for a long, long, long time, meaning what's to be done? Meaning, what about power? Power will be defeated only by power. We don't want to take power. The whole ethic of the new left has been our distaste for power. So that's a real problem. I don't know the solution to it, but I can see that it's a problem. Because indeed, the urgency of the crisis is very, very sharp and very heavy. Sorry for having talked for so long.
Thank you very much. Before we move on, for those who are excluded from the elite seating arrangement, there are at least a couple of seats available up front. So don't feel shamed. Now, if you're not opposed, I would suggest going in order to avoid confusing the harmonious seating arrangement here. Yaroslav, if you have a response to the idea of, well, the ideas that Gaspar has just put forward.
Okay. Okay, thank you for inviting me at first. I'm glad to be here with Gaspar, Tamás, and other guests. But first, let me say a few words about the concept of post-fascism and, let's say, accuracy of post-fascism. I remember a couple of years ago, I was at the airport in Barcelona, waiting for an airplane, and I bought New Left Review with an interview with Gaspar called Words from Budapest. And I read it and I thought to myself, wow, who is that man who said it precisely? What's happening now? It was the time of, especially in the Czech Republic, of protests, of racist demonstrations against Roma people, and it was time before the so-called refugee crisis and so on. And I think when I look the reality today, the concept of post-fascism, in my opinion, it has never been so accurate as today. So I have to say that text of Gaspar Tamás seemed to me as kind of a prophecy, dark prophecy, unfortunately, not very optimistic prophecy. And it also reminded me some concepts, like concepts of sociologist Seymour Martin Lipset, the concept of extremism of the center, which is a concept of the impoverished middle class defending itself against, let's say, big business on the one hand, and against minorities, the left, and the workers' movement on the other hand. However, as Gaspar said, we don't have any workers' movement today, so we have big differences, and we don't have any strong, authentic left. So, in my opinion, or in my view, this so-called post-fascism is a kind of, or as I see it, is a kind of reaction on two phenomena. At first, is a reaction on capitalist or neoliberal devastation of society, and the second is reaction as on the so-called historical revisionism. Neoliberalism brought, especially from the 1970s and in the Middle Eastern, in the Central Eastern Europe, brought destruction of solidarity, of social solidarity. It brought neoliberal individualism. It brought a lot of negative phenomena. And it brought also kind of an ideology of individualism. It destroyed society. It destroyed the structure of society. And it brought with itself a kind of a mythology, so-called mythology of American dream, especially in our post-communist world, believing that one day that if we will work hard, we will become rich and so on. And especially after the crisis in 2008 and after another crisis, this belief was shattered. And I think this belief of kind of a belief in a golden globalized world with freedoms and with prosperity, this belief was destroyed. So nowadays we are in times where people, in a way, I think, don't know what to do, what will be, and they are looking for some kind of, let's say, solidarity again. But today, the instrument of solidarity or the career of solidarity has changed. Nowadays, it's very common and very simple to find solidarity in racial or ethnicist ways. It's very, very simple and very common to find ethnic and racial solidarity, at least something which is common for the people. Today also, my personal nickname for the concept of post-fascism is kind of a fascism of our living rooms. Because I think it's not necessary for today's extreme right and fascist and racist populist and so on. It's not necessary always go to the street. For important part of this modern of this fascism is internet. Is for some of them is enough to be on internet, on Facebook, on Twitter, and spread hatred, spread false news, spread conspiracy theories, and so on. So this is also important part. And for the people who feel isolated, who feel abandoned, it's kind of a these people who feel isolated can find kind of a solidarity in this new media like Facebook and Twitter and social networks. The second aspect I mentioned is historical revisionism, because in my opinion, especially in our post-communist space, we have a common, or we have had notion that all revolutions, let's say Bolshevik Revolution, Cuban Revolution, even French Revolution, they brought only misery, death. They didn't brought anything valuable. And so it's a kind of distraction of this emancipatory notion, which all these revolutions, despite death, despite of course they brought negative things, but this kind of a notion that they also brought kind of emancipatory things as well has been destroyed in a way. For example, I studied here in Prague at the Philosophical Faculty history, and what we were taught was exactly this. We were taught historical revisionism, mainly right-wing revisionism, that all revolutions were bad mainly. That, for example, colonialism was good, it brought civilization to colonized people. That, for example, right-wing dictatorships in Latin America weren't so bad, and so on. It's kind of a reactionary thinking. And this historical revisionism, right-wing historical revisionism, is trying to destroy the emancipatory legacy of our history and of our memory, trying to destroy it completely. So in such a situation where the solidarity is articulated in racial or ethnic terms and with historical revisionism, it's very easy for today's ultra or far right and fascist to go forward and to communicate with people, and because they operate in a kind of a symbolic milieu, symbolic field or in public discourse, which is used to these phenomenons like individualism and historical revisionism. And so it's for them it's very, very easy to operate. And it's easy for them to as well to argue against things like universal human rights, universal citizenship, and so on. They can articulate inequality very easily in such a way. And for us, I think it's the task to challenge this, to argue against this, and maybe yes, maybe rethink our attitude towards power, towards challenging today's power. Yes, and I think we will discuss it later.
Thank you. Thanks. Beware of that mic. Now, Michal.
Thank you as well to be here and to have the opportunity to dispute with Gaspar Tamás and others. I would like to point that I share many opinions with Gaspar Tamás concerning the contemporary picture of our society, but I would to concentrate on some point of disproval. First, we can get down the ladder into the theoretical basement of Gaspar Tamás' concept of post-fascism. What we can see there is the concept of Georges Bataille, which consists in two line the society as divided in two parts. The first part is called the homogeneous part, and the second one is the heterogeneous part. What we see in the homogeneous society is the order, the principle of exchange, the privileges. To living successful lives and so on. And on the side of heterogeneous society, we can meet the things like madness or unemployment and all things which cannot be included in the homogeneous society. And all the picture of post-fascism operating on this basement, on the Bataille concept of homogeneous and heterogeneous society. According to Gaspar Tamás, we live in a homogeneous society, which is diminished by the fact that people enjoy some civic rights and some privileges. Gaspar Tamás spoke about the prerogative state or prerogative society. And my first question is whether the members of so-called homogeneous or prerogative society enjoy this civic and social rights, indeed. I mean that Gaspar Tamás doubt about it himself. We can observe the disconnection civic rights and social rights, and in Hungary and maybe in Poland or in the Czech Republic, even the civic rights have been curtailed, have been diminished. So I find disputable that we live in homogeneous society in the sense of Bataille. I would say that what happens around us is a paradoxical interchange between homogeneous and heterogeneous society. We can observe the phenomena heterogeneism of homogeneous society. I mean by it that just in the core of so-called homogeneous society, we can find phenomena such as so-called white trash in the United States, or the chronic unemployment, or the classical example is given by the phenomenon of precariat. This phenomena can be considered to be heterogeneous. So the heterogeneous elements live in the core of the homogeneous society. My second question is whether the concept of post-fascism needs the concept of a homogeneous society. I mean that according to classical account of fascism, there must be a kind of homogeneous society here to fascism to work. But in the contemporary society, we can see another movement. It's the movement going towards the fragmentation of society and into the stratification of the society. I would say that that the phenomenon of racism and xenophobia is out of dispute, but we should be very careful how to deal with the phenomenon. Well, there is something like a dark racist undertone in our society, as Gaspar Mikloš, Gaspar Tamás, put it. But on the other we can find to fragmentarization and to never-ending never-ending process of splitting on the field of racism. Maybe many people share the racist prejudice, but on the other hand, they are cleft among many opinion groups. Some groups support Putin, some groups is against Putin, some groups is for European Union, some group is against this, and so on. And it may be on to or it can be compatible with some racist prejudice. My thesis is that it's practically improbable to create a fundamental homogeneous society, and that the fundament and or basis of post-fascism is lacking. Thank you for attention.
I do want to give Gaspar a chance to respond to what you've all said. So one of the other, or part of the other question will be whether there are certain features of the current situation that the concept of post-fascism doesn't sufficiently grasp, and whether we need to supplement it with other things, as I think Michal was suggesting. But maybe in addition to that, or in a future comment, you could also think about what Lukasz has just said, and what Yaroslav was also pointing to in a different way. Yaroslav said how pointing to the problem of neoliberalism, which Gaspar, you also mentioned, but in particular how the extreme right, the new right, is presenting itself as the fighter against neoliberalism. We have this situation in which I think many of us who consider themselves to be on the left were waiting for the moment in which finally neoliberal hegemony would start to fall away, and we saw maybe some cracks forming in it, and we thought that we had been organizing for all these years and spreading a little bit of left discourse, and maybe this would be the moment for the left to take over. And I think maybe we didn't pay enough attention to what was happening in other parts of society, or for possibly other reasons, but we aren't the ones with the initiative at this moment, and the critique of neoliberalism would seem to have been taken up in large part by the extreme right, or at least in the rhetorical, on a rhetorical level. And at the same time, then we see nominally leftist parties which take up various aspects of this discourse of critiquing neoliberalism, along with advocating further exclusion, and the left would seem to be shifting away, or this part of the left shifts away from this traditional position that's always been maybe somewhat less than completely secure, but traditional position of being the champion of the marginalized to a position of advocating exclusion in one form or another. So yeah, I think we'll start again with Gaspar.
Well, I don't want to go into the detail of Georges Bataille or anything. Also, let's not forget that this is a 16 years old writing, and I have thought a little since about these matters. One thing I should emphasize, that Ernest Frenkel's classical view of a normal legal government and prerogative government is still a valid description of Hitler's system, in which, say, you know, thieves were still punished, in, you know, wills were executed, marriages were completed, etc., etc. The normal state went on, while the totalitarian extremist state functioned in a parallel fashion. That was unique to historical fascism and doesn't need to preoccupy us, but it's not identical with what Bataille has said, and also his term of homogeneous society and heterogeneous society. These are not two parts of society. But anyway, that's a question of history of ideas. I won't go into that. What I consider to be essential here, and I agree, you all intimated this to a certain extent, and I do agree with you, but also my original essay too, it has been developed since, has said it, and don't forget that it was published in 2000, when these extreme right parties were not so much in the march. So what I considered to be post-fascism was a whole transformation of capitalist society in that respect. And neoliberalism was an aspect of this, and because of course it has allowed this kind of discrimination and exclusion to function, and of course it elicited these fantastic attitudes that would scandalize people in 1819, you know, when the first poor laws were voted by the British Parliament. It was the first time that these attitudes that the non-deserving poor should be punished in the workhouses instead of being helped, well, that's, you know, that's really a regress. And in many, let's, you know, it's not fashionable to say, but in many, many regards, we are in regress. But let me just, trying to get rid of the, how do you call it, the Wortlaut, the real text of that essay, that's, you know, that's gone. But what I want to emphasize, and which I simply forgot to say in my introductory remarks, and which I think is extremely important, I simply forgot, it's not, that's no philosophical reason for this. What happens is a very interesting thing, that class as such is again recognized, as it wasn't under neoliberalism, when both the pro-neoliberals and anti-neoliberals were concentrating on race and gender inequality and such, and, you know, in global terms too. But how is class rediscovered by the right? It's a very interesting thing. In the following manner, class is considered to be something that is within whiteness. So within, among whites, among the white established classes, as it were, there is a class problem. There's a clear class problem. The white working class, so much talked about nowadays, but also the white middle class, or, you know, what is called in my own dear country, the Christian middle strata, or whatever. You know what Christian means, do you know? Well, it means non-Jewish. And you know what Magyar means? It means non-Gypsy. Okay, that means some negative terms, but it, but all these synonyms, you know, mean that class has appeared again. There is a kind of inequality that the present-day establishment is not satisfied with. That, you know, people should be held within the purview of whiteness. I, for example, in the most concrete way, as Joe has written in his excellent article in the Le Monde Diplomatique, I've read today, austerity for them, welfare for us. So it is not true any longer there's austerity for everybody. That was the original form for neoliberalism, i.e. for everybody except the richest capitalists. But yes, welfare state for us and austerity and inclusion for them. These them and us are differently defined in various societies. Of course, there's not a clear system, but it is quite an extraordinary, although not wholly unprecedented thing, that class is within whiteness. You see, it has a precedent in the very immoral politics of the social democratic movement that has been in favor of colonialism and colonial conquest and imperialism while fighting for equality in the metropolis, obviously. So, you know, it has a past, it has a very distributive past that encompasses also the black chapters in the history of the left, obviously. And, you know, Zeman is not the first. First were the Scheidemanns and the Noskes and the Friedrich Eberts, weren't they? And etc. etc. And you know, to name only Germans, we could name others, Plehanovs, you know. And even there was some understanding for the civilizing work of British imperialism in India in the works of Marx. The moment when this has been really understood, that this is wrong, that is 1914, when there were a few people called, you may not like those names, Lenin and Trotsky and Rosa Luxemburg, who understood that this wouldn't do. And it was the Russian Revolution, October 1917, the first and until now the only, and its sequence, internationalist revolution in world history. And that went against national conquest, annexation of territories, oppression of national and ethnic minorities, against colonialism, against secret diplomacy, against permanent armies, etc., etc., against the whole machinery of war against nations, weaker nations. Now, okay, but that seems to be the distant past, doesn't it? So now what we have is a class discourse, surprisingly for us, a class discourse coming from the right, you know, and but of course which is very much combined with race. But not in the old way, not in the old way. And a new innovative way. Well, not totally innovative, you know, if I'm not very much mistaken, Hitler's party was called the Nationalsozialistische Deutsche Arbeiterpartei. Okay, and so on and so forth. And socialist, national socialist, okay. But this is not what I'm saying, that the class within whiteness is just simply a ruse, a manipulation. This is how it has been seen by the establishment for a long time. That's true, so I agree with you. This is how, you know, so even reformers who would say, okay, yes, of course, let's have higher pensions, better hospitals, better schools, but all our better schools and better hospitals and so on are, you know, okay, fucked up by immigrants and by the colored and all those people who will pee on the corridors. We know very well who they are, and we want just to fight for the welfare of our honest, hardworking people, and here there are these parasites coming in. But this, of course, can mobilize. Well, this is not new. This can mobilize the white working class, the white middle class, and from this kind of conception, almost everybody in the establishment is contaminated. So this is why I agree with you. That's not just, you know, Boris Johnson and Trump. Of course not. And what about the colonial wars? And what about, God knows, you know very well how, you know, the white great powers have treated the colored people in the last 600 years. And there's nothing new in that. What is new is that this is coming as a refreshing new wind, as a great truth for many people. Because even this seems to be slightly less hypocritical than what went on before. So it's politically very, very clever in a way, simple, but clever. But you, at least you, should be on your guard. Because this is not the authentic talk of class, of course. So this is what I wanted to add.
Thanks, and if I'm not mistaken, I mean, I think in order to follow up, that in the original article you wrote on post-fascism, in fact, the idea is much more about a tendency within the establishment than about the rising extreme right. So now that we're faced with this complication that we have
yes.
two extremisms in some sense. But now I think we can see, open it up to whoever feels the most urgent need to respond. So, Michal, can you reach?
Well, I must agree on you, and I thank for a cute point, because the theme of class is the issue which disappeared for many years, and today we can see the refreshment of the concept, and I would say that the liberal left, I mean the Democratic Party, the United States, and other similar parties in Europe. They had politics of multiculturalism, and this politics can be considered to be some kind of internationalism, because we want to open the opportunities to other minorities, and without respect to their origin and to their positions in group, and what was suppressed was just the concept of class. The class became invisible in the politics of multiculturalism, and I would say that Donald Trump class politics is a kind of the return of the suppressed what was suppressed before, but into shape which can be seen as a perverted one. I know, but despite the fact, I mean that there is a lesson of Donald Trump.
Did you want to respond?
Sorry, but I mean, just for precision's sake, multiculturalism has nothing to do with internationalism. I'm sorry, but you know, first of all, internationalism entails an end to the nation state, and multiculturalism doesn't entail anything of the sort. And internationalism means, you know, the destruction of those structures that would be able to exercise national exclusion and national inequality. And multiculturalism, on the contrary, would just accept the parallel existence and isolated existence of all cultures. This is the basis for identity culture, that is one of the culprits of this new development, which is not so much racist as culturalist, if you wish to coin a bad term. And so, I mean, that's... But that's just a secondary issue. I just wanted to be precise about this. That's basically all. And also that class was suppressed. Well, the left, to the extent it exists, never has relinquished class. The Democratic Party of the United States of America is not a left party. It's never been one, it still isn't, and it will never be. Pace, Bernie Sanders, poor dear. Bernie Sanders, yes.
Actually, I want to keep with this idea of internationalism for a moment and maybe this can take us back to the problem of the left. Is there a way of bringing a new internationalism back today, or would any of you like to speak on what the left can be in response to post-fascism within and outside of the establishment? Yeah.
Yes, I would add one remark to your definition of class and how the extreme right is talking about class. I think extreme right today is very clever. It's because it uses different strategies. On one hand, it uses the, let's say, left-wing arguments and social arguments against liberals, against liberal right. And on the other hand, it uses sometimes neoliberal arguments against the left. So it's kind of...
And against the poor.
So it's kind of a double face. And it works pretty well, because it's kind of a opportunistic argumentation, but it works, of course. And the question also is welfare for the white working class, okay, but which kind of welfare? It's very minimalistic welfare in our so-called post-communist countries. We have flat taxation, we have almost no welfare state, and so on. So this welfare is very, very, very little. I mean, and
mostly just talk, basically.
It's talk, yes. So on the level of talk, they are very clever. They are not afraid of political manipulation, and they are very sharp. They are very, very clever when they polarize the political scene. I mean, we, the left-wingers, are so shy in comparison with them. They are not afraid to polarize, really, and they are not afraid to manipulate. They don't have the notion of kind of a truth. If they have conspiracy theory, they use it very, very quickly, and they spread it. So I think the far right, so in a way politically, the far right should be kind of an inspiration in some way for us, at least for the polarization.
My dear.
Yes. Yes, I think yes. And the second thing. I like the term post-fascism because it, in my opinion, really captures the current situation. But on the other hand, from the political point of view, it's a kind of a defensive concept. Because I think it brings the notion that, okay, we are living in kind of a exclusionary post-fascist times, we are under threat, we are under threat. That's the notion. And when we are under threat, it brings defensive posture. And one of the consequences of this defensive posture is that the radical and liberal left is being pushed together with right-wing liberals. Because in a way, I think we are afraid of something new, whatever it is. So we are pushed with right-wing liberals. But the sad reality, especially of the post-communist world, and for example of the Czech Republic, is that the majority of people don't like these right-wing liberals, because of the post-communist transformation, because of the consequences of so-called privatization and future privatizations and neoliberalism in Central Eastern Europe and so on. So the sad consequence is that a lot of us, sadly, in a way, are defending remnants of liberal democratic institutions. But, okay, it has logic, and we all know why is that happening, okay? But the sad consequence is that from the standpoint of the impoverished and majority of the people who don't like the consequences of the so-called post-communist transformation, we are viewed more or less the same as right-wing liberals, as the defendants of the old order, which in people's opinion should disappear in some way. So I think there is also a lack of imagination, of political imagination and utopian imagination of a new future. I think that's a disadvantage. And in a way, the question, what should the left should the left do in such a situation is maybe useless in this situation here and now. We should discuss it, let's say, in a political gathering, in a gathering where we should maybe establish new movement, new party, whatever. But it's in a way useless to discuss about it. I think it's necessary to act as well. And that's the point. So I wanted to say that this concept of post-fascism, analytically, okay, it also brings kind of a notion of state of exception, that something unusual is happening, that we are under danger, but it also can bring fear and sense of defensive posture which we should overcome. Yeah.
Hello, my word.
Yes.
Sorry. 2 days ago, when my book was presented, I was called a utopian, and I'm called a defensive. Okay, well, so on a more optimistic note, then, let me say that you said how clever the extreme right, or you know, more covert and overt extreme right, were because of their manipulation, the force of the manipulation, of their distortions. Well, this is our greatest chance. We should look at them. If they want to be successful, they have to lie. We don't have to lie. It's always possible to lie, but you know, in order to be forced to lie, in order to be identical with the distortion, in order to present the problem of the society such as injustice, such as inequality, such as suffering, such as deprivation, such as unhappiness, such as the total devastation of sensuality and of direct access to pleasure and to time and to nature, and the enjoyment of our own practices, not only artistic, but our own human practices. Yeah. If you talk seriously about these problems, you don't have to lie. And if indeed you use the language of liberation, that has been, of course, abused, what has not? Everything has been abused. Still, there's a chance that the language of liberation can be used in accordance to, or if not to ultimate truth, at least to a responsible and critical investigation of society. That test would not be withstood by this manipulative extreme right discourse for a minute. And so, you know, let's not be so pessimistic. So I think that I still would believe that with a minimum of Machiavellianism, that would be possible. But what I would propose, taking your question very seriously, because it's a serious question, quite apart from this account, but I think that if you ask me, so what the left could do, yes, to show the depth of bitterness and of deprivation, because that's the truth. If it sounds bitter and if it sounds, you know, fear-making and intimidating, yes, such is tragedy. Tragedy is tragic. You can't go around that, you know. I mean, but if indeed you say that your aim is somehow to go through this dark continent, and I don't mean only European continent, and to try to re-establish freedom and happiness, Well, I don't think that nobody would stop to think and say we might try. I mean, you know, we can't offer a real competition to these people in meanness. I mean, you know, I don't think, and this is why I'm here with you, because you wouldn't. And I don't want to, and I don't want you either, to offer the battle on these terms, which you are anyway bound to lose. Because you see, that's an old, old thing. You know, the communists tried in the 1920s and 30s. The social democrats have been trying. But everybody knew that the fascists are better fascists than the communists. If somebody wants fascism, he'll want the original product.
Lukasz, you've only gotten the chance to speak once. Do you have an answer to my distortion of the comments you posed in the original comment, in your initial comments? Is there something more that the left should do, or is there another challenge that you think should be posed to take the path of supporting the left as it is?
I have some comments, but I think that the left should open the floor for the possible questions. So I would cut myself in here in favor of others, because I think they are more interested in responses of others.
Thank you very much, then. Then let's open up the floor we have time for a couple of questions, I think.
It's very basic. Why now? Why is this happening now? What is the seduction, or what has gone wrong with the neoliberal plan as such to provide fertile ground for this blossom of foul? I mean, because it's always been, I can speak this very, it's always been there, right? It's been kept under wraps, and now it's out of the box. And so, for me, it would be helpful to how to respond in order to understand what I'm responding to on the larger historical front, as opposed to just like, oh, these guys are assholes.
Others?
And maybe we can collect two or three questions now. Are there any others?
Questions, objections, comments? Yes.
I just have a short question. Let's say historical fascism is traditionally based on strong leadership or on charismatic leadership, right? But it kind of usually cannot or isn't able to repair itself after the death of the leader, right? At least in terms of governing ideology or as a system. So how do you see the prospects of, let's say, today's post-fascism in these terms? Thank you.
Interesting question. Yes, both of you. Yeah.
My question is, I guess, about Umberto Eco. He formulated the concept of Urfascism.
Yeah.
And I was wondering where you might differentiate, if you're familiar with it, where it differentiates entirely. It was kind of on a continuum of this more of a psychological concept for where fascism is going, and draws this conclusion between historical fascism and post-fascism. Where do you find the differentiation between your concept of post-fascism and Urfascism?
So I think some of those were specifically meant for Gaspar, but also others are.
So what do you think, Albert?
It's your problem.
Okay. Well, very briefly, because I can see that how heroic you are, you're getting tired. Why now? Because one of the reasons is that as with technological development, the quantity of superfluous population is growing. And capitalism will have finally to think out some sort of solution to this and to say how many are we able to save and whom. Because as it stands now, from a strictly economic calculation point of view, especially as these people calculate, it's not my calculation or yours, but you know, as the mainstream is calculating on the basis of classical economics and so on and so forth, it means that about half of the world's white population can be gainfully employed, and maybe some of the other half can be kept alive, and some countries too can fend for themselves. But as to such places as Africa and all this, they'll have to fend for themselves, and let's bury them, and that's it. It's just cutting their losses. It's a result of the combined development characterized by this technological upheaval and by neoliberalism itself that has left very poor instruments in the hands of any kind of statecraft. Just, it's not there any longer. It's not simply there's less social assistance than it used to be. There are less pensions, less hospitals, less schools, etc., etc. Also, the technologies, the mindset, the idea of democratic planning, all that, you know, superstructure of the welfare state is gone. So that's one of the reasons why now it has become acute. And of course, of that, the immigration is a part of this. Okay, how post-fascism as opposed to classical fascism can reproduce itself. You know, I don't know really, but one thing seems to be said, it has become much more proteic. You know, it's going, well, for example, look at France now. The moderate right, okay, people like ourselves, you know, people who know how to handle their fork and knife, and they can have the proper codes from Proust ready. François Fillon. Well, François Fillon is much more reactionary than Marine Le Pen. Much worse in terms of policies. He might not at home talk with his daddy about how to exterminate Jews, but you know, might not be his favorite dinner time topic, as it probably has been the case in the Le Pen family. But you see, what he proposes to do with the French working class and with the immigrants in general, it's hair-raising. And he's congratulated by the great and by the good. You know, so this is how they can survive. They will transmogrify into this and that. At the moment now in Hungary, everybody knows about the Jobbik party that has been reported on as having paramilitary groups and this and that. And so. For the moment, again, Mr. Vona, who is the leader of that party, probably will have private conversations I wouldn't care to listen to, because I would be nauseous. But that at this moment he's more moderate than Mr. Orban, certainly, in most respects. Well, he has been forced by the opposition situation in which he finds himself. He has, of course, to defend democracy, because otherwise he'll be drowned by Mr. Orban, who is not choosy when it comes to adversaries. He can kick as well the far right enemy as the left enemy. He's not choosy. Enemy it should be. So that's how. So no real organization. That's quite true. The fascist organizations, as organizations, didn't prove very long-lived. That, unlike social democracy, unlike some Christian parties, unlike the communists even. Eco, Umberto Eco. It's a very seductive theory and it's very well written, and it makes one think. I think differently, and because what he says basically is that elements of fascism are also elements of our culture. That's a very seductive, yes, that's a very seductive thought, and there's a lot of empirical and intuitive truth in it. You know, towards the end of her life, Hannah Arendt had similar intuitions, and so on and so forth. I don't use the term like this. And although, you know, it's very difficult to reject some of his instances, which are really terrible. And what you asked about the fear of the masses, of the European masses, and that brings us to the neglected main topic of this discussion today, that's very true. That it is very rare, if not unprecedented in history, to tell successfully people living very hard lives that they should live even harder lives in order to help others. But that's, yes, that is true. That is psychologically and socially and economically very implausible. Question is it a good question? Is it a good question? Well, first, is it a good question morally? If indeed you are a Kantian Christian, and I emphasize both, then of course you must do everything in your power to improve the situation of the suffering. In that, and if that is true, then it has to be true, and then it has to be preached to everybody, popular or not. But is it so or not? That's the question. And that has to be linked to the our assessment of the wealth available today for advanced societies, for themselves and for those they can reach. And that wealth is very badly distributed. One category of the victims are the white poor of the European countries that are abominably treated, okay? That's because of the refugees, we won't forget the predicament of white proletarians and white agrarians and unemployed and old people in the abandoned villages of Eastern Europe and of Siberia, who are living the most extraordinarily bad, terrible lives. And no reason to forget them, and we shouldn't. They are our brothers and sisters, right? And that wealth that should be used to help them, some of it could be used, not all, perhaps it's not enough, but it should be used also to help the immigrants. And that should be negotiated. There should be a discussion, a free discussion between equals, how to use the available resources to help as many people as possible. And that situation, in which you can discuss this freely and equally, is not a situation called capitalism. I'm sorry, but it cannot be done by structural restraints. Not because all capitalists are evil. Not necessarily, but anyway, it's irrelevant. It's irrelevant. It's the system is that won't allow such a discussion. But you know, and I must say that there are still enough people in the world worried morally enough to urge such a discussion, such a debate. They won't have it. But the fact that they are pushing is very promising. So, you know, that's utopian, you know, that's one of my old terms, utopian reformism. You know, in a way, trusting to the present society to be able to solve those problems, that's utopian. Also, it's moderate, also it's reformist, also it stands to reason, also it's totally hopeless. And so I think that, you know, if you want really to be commonplace, and even if you want a bit Machiavellian as you proposed, the only thing is to have is total revolution.
And then I think it's just about time for us to close. So with that very nice thought, please take that to your next conversations or to beer later today. And thank you very much to everyone
thank you
there
too.
And
thank
here.
You.